what I'm seeing here is going on.
Well, this is
thank you. services here at East Frankfort Baptist Church. We're glad you decided to come out and worship with us today. We got a rather full plate of activities today. First and foremost, you might want to notice that there's some people behind me here. And I know they wore blue just to make Brother Kyle upset. The Oneida Baptist Choir, they're going to be performing some Christmas carols for us today. And we'll be taking up a love offering for the Oneida Baptist Institute. In front of you in the pew, there's a love offering envelope. Use that if you want to give to Oneida. The love offering envelopes, okay? If you want to give to Lottie Moon, another worthy giving opportunity for you, those are in your bulletin. Use those envelopes. And if you just want to give a tithe or an offering, put that in your regular tithe and offering envelope or put cash. Okay, but if you want it to direct it and give it to a certain ministry, be sure and label it so the tally committee will know where that needs to go. Okay, got it? Good. Our Christmas choir will be performing next Sunday morning on December 17th, so come out here and hear us. Special service, candlelight, Christmas, it's going to be December 20th at 6:30. Come out and light up a candle with us. And it's always a special time, remembering that wonderful gift of Jesus Christ, a special time here. And one more, speaking of Christmas, if you're one of those Christmas card givers and receivers, out on the opportunity table, we've got our little special post office out there, so drop your cards off in those alphabetically, please. And be sure and check it. If you haven't checked it, you've got some Christmas cards in there, more likely. So stop out there today and get that. All right. Brother Jason, if you would come and share some scripture with us, and after that, we get to hear some Christmas music.
I'm sorry, I'm holding up the thing. Good morning. Welcome to East Frankfort Baptist. Call of worship this morning will be Psalm 99. It said, "The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise their great and awesome name. Holy is he, the king in his might loves justice. You have established equity, you have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God, worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron are among his priests. Samuel was also among those who was called upon his name. They called to the Lord, and he answered them. In the pillar of the cloud he spoke to them, and they kept his testimonies and the statute that he gave them. Our Lord, our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Exalt the Lord, our God, and worship at his holy mountain. For the Lord, our God, it's all. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, for this opportunity to come to your house, Lord, to offer praise and worship to your name, for you alone are worthy. We pray that as we enter into the Christmas season, that you will help us to understand that since we were unable to come to you, you showed mercy and you came with us. And we just want to reflect and meditate on that. And Lord, we want to thank you for the precious gift. We thank you for our salvation and for those who don't have salvation. Lord, we pray in order to send upon them today and that you will come to their rescue. We ask that you'll forgive us for the times we fail you. It's in your name we pray.
Well, good morning. I'm going to move a chair out of my way real quick. We are doing Christmas songs, so I hope that's not too early for you all. You guys are kind of our dress rehearsal. We have our Christmas concert on Wednesday, so hopefully it will sound good. How does that sound? All right. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you. Truth teaches new believers to tell their friends about Jesus. But imagine Jay without the Lottie Boo Christmas offering, no more new believers, no more materials to sell. No more trainings. No more going.
See me stay. See unbelievers die. See a world unreached. This is what happens when you don't give to the Lord in your Christmas offering. See what happens when we do give? I go out. I share the gospel. People are saved, and the world is reached. Please prayerfully consider how you will help share Christ with all the nations, that all peoples may know Him.
Well, we got a special treat today. Those fine actors and actresses are going to collect up the offering today. Don't forget, we've got special love offering for Oneida, we've got the Lottie Boone Christmas offering, and your regular giving. So we're going to have a word of prayer before we begin. And if you would, bow your heads with me. Father, we come to you at this special time of year. Father, we have so many wonderful ministries, Father, that we get to give to. Father, we just pray that you'll give us a generous heart in all that we give, Father, and just give us laughter as we muse about how wonderful these gifts are going to be to the folks that receive them and how the wonderful good news of the gospel is going to be spread through them. Father, we just thank you for all you're doing in our lives right now. Father, we just pray that you always keep our eyes open for opportunities to share the gospel. And we ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
About 1970, 73, somewhere in there. I was about 5 years old, so still driving, but you know. I was down there with a fellow that I had joined or surrendered to Christ back years ago. And he went down there as a volunteer and then began to work there. Some of the things you need to know about Oneida, some of you never heard of it, I found out today. Oneida is a large high school. I don't know if it's grade school or not. And it was started, when I was there, it was handled by a fellow, I can't think of his name. He was part of the Peace Corps in Iran. And he came back there and began to work at Oneida. And he gave his life at Oneida because he didn't sleep very much. He was constantly planning day and night about what they would do next. Oneida raises its own food. It's got a huge garden. Got fields. They raise their own food. They can their own food. They serve their own food. And they take care of things around the farm. And there. General Motors back then gave them engines that they had tested. So they had a room full of V8s, 6s, things like that. Taught mechanics. Taught them how to do things like that. Learned to weld. Learned to be plumbers. Learned to be teachers. All kinds of things. Anita's been going on a lot longer than I've been around, and that's a couple weeks now. And so if you're looking for something to reach out to, and what I would recommend, you ought to go down there and see the place. You ought to go there. It's a very interesting trip. They'll take you through the barracks, they'll take you through the farm, they'll take you through the shops. They do their own maintenance. They've got their own water system, their own sewer system, and they maintain it. So it's quite a place to learn. There's kids there from foreign countries. There's kids there from states. And different backgrounds of the kids that come there, different kinds of issues. And
Good morning.
Oh,
good morning. It's a little hot. My name is Frank Stratton, and I'm the assistant to the president at OBI, and I'm honored to have the opportunity to stand before you today and share with you a little bit about what I consider a little slice of heaven in southeastern Kentucky. I want to begin by expressing my gratitude for the opportunity to speak with you today. Thank you for the invitation. Brother Kyle, thank you for having us. You've heard the best part of the presentation through the choir, I can promise you that. But I am grateful for the opportunity to share with you. I consider Brother Kyle a good friend. He's not worth a plug nickel on picking favorite sports teams to cheer for. But it's a given with the Louisville around here, but I could go even deeper than that. And I'm a Tottenham fan, so even his Arsenal soccer team gives me trouble. But no, I've come to know and really respect Brother Kyle and what he does through his work here at East Frankfort, through his work at the Capitol Commission. I'm grateful for the opportunity to share with you today. I'm grateful to be able to stand before you and say thank you. Thank you for your continued support of Oneida Baptist Institute. And the fact of the matter is that the gentleman said that there's even some people here who don't know what OBI is. And even if that is true, you have still supported OBI through your faithfulness and generosity through the cooperative program, and we are grateful for your support in that way. And I'm hoping to share with you a little bit more in depth about who we are and what we do, to where perhaps you'll be drawn to give or to support in any number of ways. I love to tell the story. It's my favorite hymn. It's when any time, you know, every once in a while we'll have good old fashioned hymn sings where you can just throw out a number and everybody will sing it. And my go to on that is I love to tell the story. It's my favorite hymn, and telling that story, the story of the gospel of Jesus Christ, is really the ultimate call on my life. I believe it's the ultimate call on every believer's life. But I love to tell the story, and I love to tell the story of Jesus, but I also love to tell the story of Oneida. I love to tell the Oneida story, and the great thing about that is the prevalence of the gospel story that is found in the Oneida story. Because the thing about it is, the truth of the matter is that anywhere you go on our campus, you are going to interact with and hear and see the gospel of Jesus Christ played out. It might be in the very fabric of our beginnings as a school to teach the love of Jesus to young children of feuding Appalachian families. That's why we started. Or it could be one of the numerous international students who have attended school at OBI and accepted Christ and then taken Christianity back to their homeland. Wherever it is, the gospel is prevalent. Perhaps it is the early morning conversation on the bus ride into school. Or maybe it's a late night discussion with a house parent in the dorm. But the gospel is at OBI. Maybe it's an advanced mathematics class or with a tutor giving a little extra help when it's needed. But the gospel is there. Maybe it's in the middle of a soccer or a basketball practice or on the farm while feeding animals. But the gospel is there. The point is, and it's this simple, that it's for as many kinds of people that the gospel exists for, as many kinds of people that the gospel exists for, which is all of them, Oneida finds a way. Oneida finds a way to present the gospel to every single one that God sends our way. I can promise you two things. When you step foot on our campus, you're going to get a grateful, appreciative welcome, and you're going to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's who we are, and that's what we do. Our motto is education for time and eternity, and we take both of the aspects of that motto very, very seriously. We seek to educate for time, but most importantly, we seek to educate for eternity with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're not what I would consider an educational ministry. There are all types of educational ministries out there. I believe that we are a ministry who educates. That's our operational standard. Is that first and foremost, the most important thing that we have, The most important story that we have to tell is that of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a story that is now getting close to its 125th year. So yes, it has been there for a long time. But it's a story that hasn't changed a lot over those 124 years, because it's a story that's been all about faith, witnessing, and making disciples. If I had to pick two verses of Scripture that would best explain who we are and what we do, it would be Matthew 28:18-20 in Acts 1:8. Matthew 28:18-20. You all are good Southern Baptists. You all had your Lottie Moon skit. I know you know Matthew 28:18-20. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." And in Acts 1:8. Acts 1:8 is the one scripture in all of the Bible that I believe truly sums up and encapsulates what we are and who we are at the Oneida Baptist Institute. Acts 1:8 says this, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses." My witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I told you that we were founded in 1899, 124 years ago, by a man by the name of James Anderson Burns. We were founded right where we still find ourselves located today, in the valley that is surrounded by the Redbird River and Goose Creek and Bullskin Creek. And we were founded there as a chance for what he believed was the only way to end the local feuding in Clay County. You know, a lot of people, everybody has heard of the Hatfields and the McCoys, right? Everybody knows that story. What a lot of people don't realize is the actual bloodiest feud in Kentucky was not the Hatfield and the McCoy feud in Clay County. It was the Baker-Howard feud in Clay County. And James Anderson Burns, our founder, was actually involved in that. He was a literal feuding mountaineer. He was actually even pistol-whipped and left for dead in a ditch coming off of one of those feuds. And as he came out of that, the Lord saw fit to change his heart and to change his mindset. And he began, and he had a vision about the importance of ending the hatred that fueled those feuds. And he knew that the only way to end the hatred that was inherent there was to do it by teaching the love of Jesus Christ. So him and a fellow co-worker began to hatch this plan and called forth factions from all of these feuding families to come together for a meeting. You can imagine that was a pretty hair-raising experience. It's one that the smallest of mishaps could have led to who knows what. But they brought these feuding families together and they pitched their vision of using the love of Jesus to shift the mindset of those families. And by the time the meeting was done, the two leading patriarchs of the two families had agreed to work together to fund and to build this school that still sits the same place, telling the same story that it did 124 years ago. In 1899, tuition to attend the Oneida Baptist Institute was $1 a month. Even at that, they weren't always able to pay that. So there was a bartering system. They paid with chickens and goats and cows. They paid in any way that they could, but it was $1 a month. We're currently reconnecting to our founding. Oneida, throughout its history, has had any number of ways that the Lord has seen fit to use it to tell the story of the gospel, whether that's through international students in our dormitories or local Appalachian students who come in for a quality Christian education. We currently run 4 bus routes out the hills and the hollers of Clay County and Housley County, Kentucky. And we bring a vast majority of our student body in on school buses every day, just like your local public schools do. But we use that opportunity, just as we did in 1899, and just as Lord willing, we will in the year 2100, to tell people the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have a lot of favorite things about OBI, but I have 2 favorite things that really stick out. The first one is that I told you that the tuition for students in 1899 was $1 a month. I can tell you because a faithful, generous Kentucky Baptist like yourself, local commuting students today pay $0 in tuition to attend the Oneida Baptist Institute. We're able to provide that. We're able to provide that because of people like you and your support for us individually and your support in giving through the cooperative program. We are glad to be able to do that. And the second favorite thing about Oneida, about OBI to me, is that you don't have to be a Christian to attend our Christian school. I love the fact that you don't have to be a Christian to attend our Christian school. Now, some Christian schools, they don't operate that way, and that's their prerogative. They make either the student or at a minimum maybe one or both parents be professing believers of Jesus Christ before they can go to their school. Personally, I love the fact that Oneida embraces the Great Commission aspect of Christian education. We want all people to come to our school because we want to graduate saved people. That's why we exist. If we can't tell the story of the gospel effectively if we don't have lost people to hear it. That's the whole point of the gospel. So I love the fact that you don't have to be a Christian to attend our Christian school. Now we're going to touch on that a little bit later on, and you're going to hear a wonderful story of the power and the faithfulness of God, but that's for the end. I said the verse that I believe most encapsulates who we are as OBI is Acts 1. And I'm going to read that to you again, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I believe OBI is the quintessential Acts 1:8 ministry. I believe we fulfill to the utmost the call and the promise of Acts 1:8. The choir that you got to hear from just a few minutes ago, they're now sitting out here. I want to share with you a little bit. That choir is made up, today I think there's 16 of them if I counted right. But in just those 16 people, there are representatives of Kentucky, California, Florida, Georgia, Ethiopia, Nigeria, Taiwan, Thailand, and China. Did I miss anybody? Did I get everybody? 16 students, 4 states, 6 countries. That is Acts 1:8. You see Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth represented in that group. And you see the same thing played out on our campus on a daily basis. I can tell you that that is not a staged group for me to be able to get here and tell you that they're represented. That's just the way it fell. That's the way the cookie crumbled. That's where they are from. And that story plays itself out time and time and time again across our campus on a daily basis. And I want to just share with you, because I can stand and I can tell you, I can talk to you about the story of Oneida. I can talk to you about the history of OBI. But what we're about, who we're about, and what makes Oneida, Oneida, is the same thing that makes East Frankfort, East Frankfort, and that is its people. The stories of the people are what make us a group. So I'm going to share with you just real quickly a little bit about our Acts 1:8 vision. Because Acts 1:8 starts, it says, "You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem." And we feel like our clarion call to deliver the gospel is to our Jerusalem. And it is our local students, the students that are there in our area of Appalachia. I don't have to tell you. You people know well that southeastern Kentucky, the Appalachian region in general, is not an easy place to live. It's not an easy place there. I began talking about the feuds that took place, and there's still battles that are raging in Appalachia. It's the same battles that are raging in Frankfort, all across the Commonwealth, all across the country. But there's a battle, there's a war raging. And we're called to minister in the midst of what some people would say are some of the darkest circumstances in our country today. And we currently have, our current enrollment is about 240 students. And about 80% of those are local students who come in, commute, either by get dropped off or picked up on one of our bus routes. Reminded of one still young student, I think he's in the fourth grade, his name is Caleb. Caleb has been with us now since he was a kindergartner. Caleb lives with his grandfather in a little community called Island Creek. It's about 14 miles, give or take, from our campus. And Caleb's grandfather would bring him to the bus stop. It'd be about a 4.5 mile trip every morning to catch the bus to come to OBI. Now, the time that he was coming out to take him to catch the bus, the Clay County Public School bus was driving right by his house. But Caleb's grandfather knew the importance of Caleb to see the gospel lived out, because he knew that Caleb hadn't gotten to see that in his own home, because Caleb's parents fight that same battle that is so prevalent in our culture and in our society today. The battle against addiction and against drug abuse and poor choices. He knew that Caleb needed to see the gospel played out. So instead of just putting him to the end of the driveway to catch the bus to the local public school, he drove him to the OBI bus stop and put him on the bus for 12 miles a day, morning and afternoon, so he could see the gospel lived out. That's made possible because of people like you. Because Caleb couldn't come to OBI if there was a large monetary investment that had to be made by his family, because they wouldn't make it. They couldn't make it. But Caleb's able to attend OBI because of you. We're able to reach our Jerusalem because of people like you. But Acts 1:8 doesn't stop just in Jerusalem. It says also that you'll be my witnesses to Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria. And we have our share of students from our Judea and Samaria. I'm reminded of a student back in the mid-2000s when I was there working the first time, by the name of Connor Delaney. Connor came to us from northern Kentucky, and Connor was a typical teenager in that if there was a boundary, Connor was going to find that boundary, and then he was going to see exactly how far over he could step that boundary before somebody would say something. And he found it often. He found it often. But because I am often forgiven for my own ways of finding some of God's boundaries and stepping to the edge of them, and then honestly seeing how far over I can step, Connor received patience and forgiveness at OBI. Connor would stand here and tell you that he probably received much more than his fair share of patience and forgiveness at OBI. But Connor came to us fighting some of the same battles that we've already talked about, struggling with some of the same struggles that we've discussed. But Connor was shown love and forgiveness and patience. Oh, the patience that he was shown. to the point where Connor graduated in 2012, and I can count on about three times a week, Connor and his young wife and their young child will have pictures posted on Facebook of some family activity that they have done, some place that they have gone, a lot of times involving their local New Testament church family. I can tell you, when Connor stepped foot on OBI's campus, anybody would have said it's going to be the grace of God that allows that story to be told of Connor, and it is. It's a story that is told time and time again. Connor Delaney is a perfect example of our Judea and Samaria kids that come to us and hear and see the gospel played out and lived out. But Acts 1:8 doesn't stop at Judea and Samaria only either. It says where? It says into the end of the earth. We are able to reach our ends of the earth as well. There are currently, I've touched a little bit on it already, but that's just a small picture of our campus diversity. There are currently 13 nationalities living on our campus in the small valley in the middle of absolute nowhere. Somebody told me earlier today that they had been to Oneida, and you know what? When somebody comes to Oneida, you know one thing. You knew and you know that they were coming to Oneida because you don't come through it to get anywhere else. I can promise you that. But God has seen fit that in our little pocket in the middle of nowhere to bring the nations to a place where they are going to hear about Him. And ultimately, the story that I like to share about our ends of the earth is the story of Kai Kai. Kai Kai was a student who was there. Kai Kai was a wonderful tennis player. Kai Kai received a full scholarship and was the number one seed for Asbury after he graduated from OBI here, not far down the road. I mean, just a world-class tennis player. He was a great kid. He was a great student. But Kai Kai was with us for 4 years. And even with all of those positive attributes, at no point in time did Kai Kai ever, in his time at Oneida, had he ever made a profession of faith. He had seen the gospel. He had heard the gospel time and time and time again. But at no point did he ever profess Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. That is, until the Friday before Kai Kai's graduation. This is 4 years in. Kai Kai, a wonderful student, a wonderful young man, but one who at the time had not made the most important decision of his life. He was actually missing graduation to play in the state tennis tournament, so he knew he was leaving campus that Friday. And he poked his head after 4 years. He poked his head into the president's office. And more important than any all-state tennis team, more important than any A on a trigonometry paper that he made, more important than any English lesson or English class that he took or learned, on that Friday, Kai Kai poked his head into the president's office. And he said, "Today, I believe Jesus." And that's how Kai Kai left our campus. Our prayer, most important thing that we strive for on a daily basis, when our faculty and staff wake up in the morning and when they lay their head on their pillow at night, is the repetition of that story time and time again. We have everything a school has, but because of the gospel of Jesus, we have so much more. And we're able to fulfill that calling because of people like you. I told you that you don't have to be a Christian to come to our Christian school. In fact, statistics tell us now, at this point, about 75 to 80% of our students come to us without a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's a substantial number. But I can stand before you today and I can tell you that even with those numbers of 75 to 80% of the students coming to us without a relationship with Jesus Christ, every graduating senior in the class of 2023 professed a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. When you see our bus, when you see our name on maybe on the scroller, on the evening news, with sports scores, or when any time you hear about OBI, celebrate what we're doing in that realm. Maybe it's a basketball score, maybe it's a soccer score, whatever it might be. Celebrate what our kids accomplish there, but know that more important than celebrating that is that represents opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to tell the gospel and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with people who desperately need to hear it. You have made that possible already. How can you continue to support us? And this is how we're going to close. It won't take long, but I do. It shouldn't surprise you that as a former Baptist pastor, it is alliterated. We've got four P's on how you can continue to support us. First and foremost, pray for us. Pray for us every day, please. Because every day we're seeking out opportunities to tell the good news of the gospel. And with that comes attacks from the one who doesn't want that story told. Pray for us. Pray for our students. Pray for our staff. Pray for us as an institution that we would continue to be faithful to who we have been and to what we have been called to be. Pray for us. But then also promote us. I'm going to ask you if you would to promote us. Promote us to students who might could benefit from having an education for time and eternity. And I'm here to tell you, I might be a little biased, but that is every student. I say it before you, and I'm not ashamed to tell you that my humble belief is that Oneida Baptist Institute is the greatest school on the face of the earth. I truly believe that. So promote us to people, promote us to students who could come and benefit from that education. But also promote us to staff and to support staff. It takes people to do what we do. So perhaps you know a retired teacher who's retired and maybe they just weren't quite ready to give it all up. We're always looking for qualified teachers to come alongside us in this mission of telling the good news. Promote us to students and staff, and then maybe you're called to partner with us. I've already touched a little bit on the financial support aspect of OBI, and you're already doing it through your gifts of the cooperative program. But maybe as you seek God's guidance and His will, you might be called to partner with us in a different way. I'm here to tell you that our business model is not one that would probably be repeated very often, very successfully anywhere else. 10% of our operating budget comes from tuition dollars. 10%. 20% of our operating budget comes from through the cooperative program. That leaves, and I'm not a math expert, but that leaves 70% of our budgetary needs that is left to the faithful, generous giving of God's people. Now, we've done that for 124 years. I don't have any reason to believe that God is going to quit in His faithfulness to us. But pray about how you might partner with us. And then fourth and finally, I'm going to ask, pay us a visit. Come and pay us a visit. Brother Kyle has been to speak in chapel a time or two. Can't wait to be able to get him back to do that again. And when he comes, or even when he maybe on a different day, I want to challenge you to come and visit us at OBI. We will. You can go to chapel with us. We'll feed you lunch. We'll give you a campus tour, and you'll see and get a better grasp of what it is that God is doing at OBI, because I can sit here and I can talk to you all day, and some of you are looking at your watch and think, "Well, you kind of already have," but it's not gonna. It doesn't get the point across. It doesn't get the feel across. Like stepping foot on our campus and interacting with our students and seeing how God is constantly working His will and His might and His power in our midst. There is a different feeling when you step foot on campus. Come and pay us a visit. Like I said, come to chapel. Go to, we'll feed you lunch in our dining hall. We'll give you a campus room. We'd love to have you come and see what it is that we're doing and what it is you're accomplishing through your support at the Oneida Baptist Institute. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity together, Lord, as believers in you, and to herald your birth, Lord, to tell the story of the goodness of your gospel, and Lord, to tell how you have been faithful to your work at the Oneida Baptist Institute. Lord, nothing that we accomplish is accomplished by ourselves. Nothing that is worth getting done is gotten done by us alone. Your hand and your will is all that matters. We thank you for your faithfulness. We praise you for your goodness. And Lord, we ask that you continue to put your hand, to wrap your arms around your work at the Oneida Baptist Institute. We ask these things in your Son Christ's precious name. Amen.
What an excellent job, choir and Frank. Will you give them a round of applause? Very good. No pressure. Our choir next week, you got cantata. No pressure, but you've got to compete against that. You know, next week they're gonna say y'all did great, but you're not Oneida great. So I'm just gonna prepare those in the choir for next week. Speaking of choir, tonight at 5:00, I believe. Tommy and them weren't able to be here. Providentially hindered. They should be here tonight. But 5:00 tonight, choir practice, one of your last practices before you got to compete against Oneida. I love Oneida Baptist Institute. Went this past semester and got to preach, got to meet some students, did some Q&A with some high schoolers, which I actually loved. I probably liked it more than I should have. It was really good, smart students, really good questions. That if only our churches would ask questions like that. You know, that'd be great. But I think the world of OBI, I think the world of Frank, despite his poor taste in teams to root for. Come on, you Gunners. But well done. Also, our kids, you did excellent. All y'all spread out. Well done in reminding us of the importance of Lottie Moon. Right now as we speak, in our Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth, lives are being transformed by the power of the gospel because of your gifts and because of your going. Right now, we have in this church, not only we want to support institutes and agencies like OBI and offerings like Lottie Moon and Liza Broadus, which supports me at the Capitol and others, but also we have a new church plant that we're the sending church in Oynton, who during Thanksgiving went door to door and gave out food and told people about Jesus. We've got an update from Dylan. We'll play next week, who is in Panama right now learning the language so that he can help tell people about Jesus. You're changing the world simply by being involved at East Frankfort Baptist Church. So I want to thank you all for that. You still have opportunity to give to Oneida, give to Lottie Moon, and of course give to the church. So please take advantage of that. It's been a fantastic Sunday. I've been looking forward to this for some time. Next time I'm at Oneida, let me know. Or when next time I'm there, let me know if you want to go. And because I always need a riding buddy, it can be quite a long drive. And podcasts are nice, but a friend would be even better. So I'd love for you to come down there with me and visit. You will absolutely love the place and love to meet the students. Some of the staff are okay. They just don't root for the right teams. All right. We will be serving them lunch afterwards. So at the end of the service, come by, shake their hands, tell them how great they did and all that. And also our kids, tell them. You got something you want to say, Brantley? You forgot? If you think of it, let me know, and we'll announce it tonight. All right. We do have a few special guests. One of them is Frank's daddy, who's a pastor down in Schweitzer. If you have not met Jay, shame on you. He's been in Frankfort longer than you have, probably. And he's been pastoring longer than you have. I think the world of Jay. He's been actively involved in our association and has changed a lot of lives. So I'm going to ask and he's, of course, Frank's daddy, so he's to blame for all of this. Jay, will you close this in prayer?
Father, we do thank you. We do